Friends, welcome to this service on the 25th of October. A very different kind of service because sadly today we are in some of our churches unable to meet live due to some current restrictions and our desire to take care of ourselves and of our community. I'm grateful to Pat at Bromber who has produced your harvest service for you, and grateful for you at Bromber and all those who have in the last week provided goods to the food bank. Thank you so very much. So for those at Bromber, this is an additional service, and for those of us in Trinity, Hope Farm and Little Sutton, our act of worship. God invites us into holiness. So come, let us enter and rejoice. We enter God's holiness. We are calmed by God's peace. We are warmed by God's love. Let us be challenged by God's teaching. Amen. We sing our first hymn, joining together on a number of verses from the beautiful hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King. And it's played for us this morning and sung for us by Adrian Pallant.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Alleluia, Alleluia. O burning sun with golden beam and silver moon with softer gleam, O praise him. Sail in heaven along. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Oh, rising morn in praise rejoice, and lights of evening find a voice.
Him, oh, praise him.
Thank you, Adrian, and thanks for singing along, everyone, all creatures of our God and King, from the largest to the smallest. Let's pray, shall we? Let us pray. We thank you, loving God, for those who share the gospel. And we remember now those who introduced us to you, those who have loved us, who challenged us, who nurtured us, those who answered and still answer our questions, and those who encourage us to grow in faith. We thank you for our churches and for the churches for which we have an affection or to which we have a link. We thank you for the groups we are involved with, the groups that we miss and the people we miss. We thank you for those who share the good news of Christ, for ministers and preachers, for missionaries and writers, for all who hear your call. We thank you for those who've responded to your call, for those training for their vocation and ministry. We thank you for teachers and tutors in theology and religious studies. And on this day we give you thanks for Jen Pilling, ordained as deacon into St. James's at Ince. We pray for her and her ministry. May we see you in those who share the gospel, and may we be touched by your holiness. In the name of Jesus, amen. A prayer of confession. God said, "Be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy." For the times when we have not loved you with all our heart, mind, soul and strength, Lord, we are sorry. Restore your holiness in us. For the times when we have not loved our neighbours as ourselves, Lord, we are sorry. Restore your holiness in us. For the times of apathy and indifference, Lord, we're sorry. Restore your holiness in us. Jesus came that we might be holy. Let us seek his forgiveness and rejoice in his goodness and grace. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We're going to reflect on a psalm. We're going to see the words of the psalm and also some music behind it. Just at your own time and your own space and pace, let's say these words to Psalm 1.
Thank you.
That was Psalm 1. We hear now our Gospel reading from Matthew 22, verses 34 to 46.
When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they got together, and one of their lawyers asked Jesus a question to check him out. Which is the greatest of the commandments of the law? And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with the whole of your heart, with the whole of your soul, with the whole of your understanding. This is the first and the greatest of the commandments. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two commandments hang the entirety of the law and the prophets." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question, saying to them about the Messiah. "Whose son is he?" And they answered, "David's." And Jesus said, "Well, why is it then that David, led by the Spirit, calls him Lord, when he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet'? So if David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one was able to give him an answer. And from that day on, they didn't ask him any more questions.
Friends, that was Matthew's Gospel. As we reflect on that command of Jesus to love each other, let's see and listen to this song written by Graham Kendrick and sung by him, "Love Each Other."
Love each other in the way that I
Reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 1 to 8. Paul's ministry in Thessalonica. You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without results. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God we dared to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God, who tests our hearts. You know we never use flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else. Even though as apostles of Christ we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you. Just as a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. Because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may have heard the story, but a few years ago I was out shopping. That's not unusual. I do like shopping for anything. Even I like shopping for bleach and toilet paper. I just like shopping. But there I was getting a few pieces together, and I was in a queue. We're used to queuing at the moment, aren't we? And there in front of me was an older couple. I'm not very good at ages, but they were an older couple, probably in the late 80s, maybe even early 90s. And they were placing their items quite slowly, but meticulously on the conveyor belt. They both helped each other, and it was lovely to see. When a tin fell off the conveyor belt, I caught it, and then I put it back, and that began a bit of a conversation. I had my collar on, and they said, "You're a minister. How lovely." And I said, yes, I'm a minister. And the lady said, there are more women ministers now, aren't there? And I said, yes, that the ether are. There's a few more. And after a short conversation, she said, "Oh, I wish I'd got married by a lady. That would have been nice to have had a lady conduct our marriage ceremony." I asked them, "How long have you been married?" And she said, "Well, actually, we're approaching our 65th wedding anniversary." "And how lovely," I said, I replied, and wished them every well and every blessing. As they were paying for their goods and packing away, the young cashier who'd overheard the conversation said, "I can't imagine being married to someone and the same person for 65 years. And with great wisdom and somewhat tenderness, the lady with wisdom who was in front of me, the older lady, said, "Well, my dear, don't get married until you can." The cashier didn't quite know how to respond, but what wise words, loving each other. We have in our reading yet another confrontation with Jesus and the religious leaders. We've had a number of confrontations in the past few weeks. Jesus has been tested by them significantly, and he's passed yet another test, the test about money and the test about giving money and rendering unto Caesar. And in this test, he'd shut them down because he responded in such a way that the Pharisees could not yet again argue with. Now, the Sadducees were more of a political group, and the Pharisees were the keeper of scripture and biblical law. I wonder if you know how many laws there are. Well, there are approximately 632 laws and rules for the practice of their religion. And one of them asked Jesus a question: which commandment in the law is the greatest? Basically, they wanted Jesus to do the impossible. To think about it, over 600 laws, they wanted Jesus to break it down to the most important one. Jesus was asked to prioritise the most important law, and that's relatively an impossible task. But he broke it down into two commandments. These are based from early Hebrews, from Deuteronomy 6 verse 5 and Leviticus 19 verse 8. And he puts them both together, and when put together, they read this: you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And you must love your neighbour as yourself. Jesus is simply saying that if we truly love God and our neighbour, then we would naturally want to keep the other commandments. Jesus here is focusing on the positive of what we could do instead of the negative of what we can't do. Many people say that the Bible's full of rules of things you can't do. In the Greek, it tells us that Jesus pretty much silenced these Sadducees. Sometimes when someone is giving a very long and complicated explanation, we have the urge to say, just will you get to the point? A bit like maybe the sermon, just get to the point. Well, it was under a different set of circumstances that Jesus does get to the point about what the Bible is all about. Love God, love others. That's a good mission statement for any church. It sounds simple, and it is simple to say, but sometimes we know, sometimes it can prove to be a little difficult to put into practice. All of the big, important stuff about God and people and relationships among the respective parties can be boiled down into a threefold love. Love of God, love of neighbour, and love of self. There's a heightened hostility going on here with Jesus as we approach the end of Matthew's gospel. What will we expect from Jesus as he turns his face to Jerusalem, faces the cross? He's turned over the tables in the temple. He's cursed a fig tree. He's told three pretty offensive parables. How do we expect those on the receiving end of his prophetic words to react? When those with prestige and position are challenged, when their presuppositions are upturned, they react with hostility and fear. It's true today too, not just those thousands of years ago. No sooner has Jesus finished offering three parables about two sons, the wicked tenants, and the wedding banquet, than he begins to question their ability to love other people. The answer that Jesus gives is hard to argue with. Even though the Pharisee who asked was a lawyer, it seems they just can't let it go. What stands out to me most of all is that Jesus is winding down his earthly ministry. This passage after his entrance into Jerusalem. He's getting to the point. He's approaching the cross. He's done with being tricked by questions and dealing with the same old antagonism from the same old people. He goes on after this to give nothing less than a scathing criticism of the Pharisees. The Pharisees and Sadducees who continually just want to play games. They wanted to use theology, that word of God, as a weapon against Jesus. And Jesus wasn't having anything of it. He gave constant deflections and in the process let us all know what is best in life. And it isn't war or defeating one's enemies. It's love. There's a lot of times in life when a lot of people turn this commandment of love into another kind of Pharisaic trick. What does it mean to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul and mind? In a world that we live in, where religion is mentioned as the cause and root of so many problems, how would it be that we challenge people's assumptions by saying love is actually what it's all about? Jesus summed up all of the law in this way, but still Jesus' ideas were way over the head of his enemies. Should we love God or neighbour first? For Jesus, this is a nonsensical question. For him, we love God by loving our neighbour. One goes with the other. We love God and we love our neighbour. So who then is our neighbour? In ancient Jewish culture, it's those in one's family, those in the tribe, and those who live with you and along with you are your neighbours. Your enemies are not your neighbours. That's what they would have been brought up with. However, Jesus extends neighbour to everyone. Everyone. Even our enemies. Love your enemies. And should our neighbour be extended too, not just to humankind, but to the environment, to others, to all creatures? Jesus never spoke to that, but neither did he deny it. Jesus was so countercultural that his adversaries could not possibly grasp what he was even talking about. But don't think we are any better. There is hatred and violence and pettiness and self-righteousness in Christian religion all around the world. The scars of that last a long time. How many people have we put off coming to church by our action or our inaction? And I confess, I have done that too. I don't point a finger. I point three back at me. The scars last a long time. And our culture around us still has trouble with Jesus. Or maybe they have trouble with the church. Maybe it's trouble with how we have acted towards others. Maybe sometimes we feel like silencing Jesus, just like the Pharisees and the Sadducees, when we are convicted and reminded to love each other. When Jesus tells us to love everyone, he is not saying that we should have warm, fuzzy, warm feelings about everyone. That's pretty much impossible. Love is not essentially shown by feeling. It's shown by action. What we do counts in spite of our feelings. Love is a risk, and our hearts might break. Mother Teresa said, "May God break my heart so completely that the whole world falls in." Perhaps this loving other people means we need to change our view. There is this wonderful story. It's been going around for years, and I have no doubt you've heard it. It's a story of a captain on the bridge of a large navy vessel, and he sees a light ahead of him. They're on collision course, and he signals, "Alter your course 10 degrees south." The reply comes back saying, "Alter your course 10 degrees north." And so the captain signals again, "Alter your course 10 degrees south. I am a captain." The reply is signalled back, "Alter your course 10 degrees south. I am a seaman of third class." The furious captain signalled, "Alter your course 10 degrees south. I am a battleship." The reply, "Alter your course 10 degrees north. I am a lighthouse." When Jesus asks us to love God with all of us, all of ourself, what does that look like? What would it look like in our lives to love others with all of our heart and mind and soul and being? And what would it look like to other people? How do we change to do that? Well, we pray daily. We talk to God. We talk to God as though he's a close friend. We don't just pray when we want something. We pray without ceasing. We read scripture. We establish a daily walk in communion with God. He already knows us. We just need to take the time to get to know him better and establish a deeper relationship with him. That's where it begins. Loving God totally. A complete commitment to him. With our energy. Our self. Our emotions. Our talents. Our time. Our minds. Our resources. He demands our soul. Our life. Our all. perhaps practically, if you're struggling with somebody, pray about them. Mention their name to God, the author, perfecter of our faith, who demands our soul, our life, our all. Amen.
Father, hear the prayer we offer, not for ease that prayer shall be, but for strength that we may ever live our lives courageously. Not forever in green pastures do we ask our way to be, but the steep and rugged pathway may we tread rejoicingly. Not forever by still waters would we idly rest and stay, but would strike the living fountains from the rocks along our way. Be our strength in hours of weakness, in our wanderings be our guide, through endeavor, failure, danger, Father, be there at our side.
Friends, we're going to, in a moment, pray for others and for ourselves. This also may be the time in some of our worship when we take the offering. I'm very grateful for all of you who have contributed and continue to contribute to the life of the church. We are still seeking to make a difference in our community by word and by deed, by helping others who find themselves trapped in a cycle of poverty, for those for whom this awful devastation of COVID-19 has brought about additional despair because of loss of income and jobs. And for the life of our church, of course, we are missing our lets and our users because of their presence, and we miss seeing them, but also their financial contribution to our church. Thank you to all of you who have contributed to the life of our church. If you're able to respond even more in the next few weeks, we would value that, either by increasing your giving or giving a one-off payment, perhaps by having a standing order as opposed to using your envelopes, anything that could help us in this intervening period where things are very difficult. But also, if you are in need, if you need some additional support, then please do contact us and we'll do all we can to help and journey alongside you. Friends, let us pray. We pray for peace in the world, peace between nations, peace within families, peace where there's oppression, peace where there is injustice. May your kingdom come and may we love our neighbour as ourselves. We pray for those who are victims of discrimination because of their ethnicity, disability, nationality, appearance, religion, gender identity, sexual orientation, or for any other reason. We pray that we may learn to accept and respect those who are different from us. May your kingdom come. May we love our neighbour as ourselves. We pray for all who suffer or have suffered abuse, that they may have healing and comfort and be able to love as you love them. We bring to you those who commit abuse, praying that they may see the pain they cause and repent and experience your love themselves. May your kingdom come. May we love our neighbour as ourselves. We pray for those who live in fear because they do not have enough to be able to feed themselves or their family. We give you thanks for the work of Food Bank, for Port Grocery, for other social supermarkets. May we all learn to share the generous bounty of your world. May your kingdom come. May we love our neighbour as ourselves. We pray for those who mourn and struggle this day, that they may know the near presence of your comfort. For those who embark in hospital appointments, for those waiting for results of tests, may they know your strength and your peace. May your kingdom come. May we love our neighbour as ourselves. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. So our final hymn for our act of worship today, we sing along to two songs, My Jesus, My Saviour, and The Splendour of the King. My Jesus.
Splendor of the King. Saviour. Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty
friend, has been good to join together in worship today, whether it's by video or by podcast. It's good to have your presence. Our final blessing. May the God of peace and strength, the God who is close to us, restore us and lead us. As we have been loved, may we love one another in the strength and through the grace of Jesus. And the blessing of God, Father, Son and Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.